And what I was trying to do as I read the gospel and I looked at it in several different Bibles, because I like to see the different versions, and then I like to look at it historically a little bit, and just trying to figure a lot of stuff out. And as I was doing that, it occurred to me that in the reading, we have examples of two different groups of people, and they are the opposites. They are, you know, there's always this big group in the middle, but we have the wealthy and the poor, and those were the ones that were represented in our gospel today. So the wealthy were the scribes, and scribes at the time were maybe like lawyers. So they were wealthy, they did well, and they were higher crust, you know, they were the I'm not going to come up with the word, but they were the top dogs. And then there was the poor widow, and she represented the least. She represented all of the folks that we don't necessarily see as we go through life. We kind of, our eyes just seem to get shielded or glazed over, and we don't notice those people. And that's the poor widow represents those. So they don't have a voice. But even without a voice, she gave two copper coins, and she gave those from her poverty, and it was all that she had. And clearly, I mean, Jesus says that is more valuable than the large sums that the scribes were giving. So I read that and I thought, you know, there are kind of a lot of parallels in, around us for those same two groups. I had talked with Pastor also just about, we were talking in general the Christian church, and we were talking about the growth of it. And we're part of the developed world, and Christianity in the developed world, the numbers seem to be declining. The Christian church is losing members. The churches are closing, and you find that in America, but we also find that in Europe. And it's just, I don't know, it's just a phenomenon with the developed world. And then we have the undeveloped world. And overall, the Christian church is exploding. The growth is just exponential. And that all of that growth is coming from the underdeveloped and undeveloped world, where folks are, you know, threatened, they're not allowed to show their faith. I don't remember the exacts, but he told me about a church that had initiated, then there was a change in the government, and so they had to go underground, and they were underground for like 10 or 12 years, and then there was another government that came in, and suddenly it was okay to be Christian again. And so the church came out, and it was thousands stronger than it had been when it went underground. It just, because despite the fact that they were having to hide their love of God, it still spread. It just was on fire. The people in the undeveloped countries are on fire for God's word. And we're not so much. And we know that. We've talked about membership declining or not growing here and in this whole area. So, and we're just representative of what's happening in the world globally. So I thought it was kind of represented with the scribes and the poor woman also. And then I started thinking about cities here in America. Bucyrus is a small town, and Bucyrus would be like the poor widow, because we're not well off. We, the big cities have a ton of money, all these people, and that's where all of the movie stars and all the sports heroes, everybody lives in big cities, and we're out here just trudging along in our small town. So things are, they get kind of tough out here. And we see a lot of decline. You know, you read the paper every day, and there's drug abuse, and there's drug use, there's addiction, there are issues with drugs every day. There's homelessness. You know, we don't think about homelessness because the homeless are one of those people that we just overlook. We don't see them anymore. But there are homeless right here in Bucyrus, right here in our county. We have homeless people. Our population is declining, and that's an issue. I read in the paper the 2020, I think was the group, and they're trying to come up with a plan to stem the loss of our young people. So as the population declines, the jobs leave because we don't have young people to offer as workforce anymore. And our population is getting older, and it gets older because everything is feeding into it. The young people leave to find jobs. Once they find jobs, they go to the city, so the cities grow that much more. The small towns lose that much more. It just spirals. And we have an increase in the low-income population here in town. And we have that because there are single mothers. They almost immediately fall into the low-income part. But for us here, a problem with the low-income is frequently it's in the elderly population. And it's in the elderly population because once one of the spouses will pass away, and that leaves one person, a single aging person, living on half the income and trying to get by, and there's not a lot happening to offer assistance just because of all of the other issues that come with a smaller town. And big towns, they have a lot of these issues as well, but they have so much more and so many more people and so many more jobs that, you know, when you think about the recession that we went through a few years ago, when you look around town, here, we still see signs of that in places. We still see signs that places that just haven't rebounded from the recession. But when you go into one of the bigger cities, you see that everybody's bounced back. It's just amazing. They're growing, their businesses are moving in, people are working, they're getting higher income, they're getting raises. It's really just amazing what is happening in the large cities. And it's not going to be long before people just aren't even, it's just not even a thought about the recession that we went through. It's just one of the, again, it's another parallel between the scribes and the poor widow. It's the big cities and the small cities. Then I found one other one, and it really had to do with the church again. But it wasn't the local Christian church, it was really more churches in towns, churches here in the United States. The scribes are represented by the TV evangelists, by the big mega churches in the cities that have hundreds and thousands of members. You know, there are churches out there that are just incredible, they're just huge with numbers. And then there are churches like ours, a small country church. We have a couple hundred members. You know, we are not busting at the seams, but we do okay. We do okay. And to take the comparison a little bit further, the large churches, they flat dollars, they bring more in to provide for permission. They bring in a lot more than our church ever will, just straight numbers. But I challenge them to look at percentage, what's available and what's given. And I would put our church up against any of them, because like the widow gave from her poverty and she gave all she had, I believe that our church is very much like that. I mean, look around. This is it. These are the folks that we have to draw from and look at all of the things that we did. This is an example. These are all samples of the amazing things that our women of the church do. They really, it's incredible. It is truly incredible what the women do. They have taken our mission and they put it on their shoulders and they run with it. And they have so many different ministries that they bring to our community. I don't think you find this kind of activity, this kind of support in a big mega church. I don't think you find it. This is what we do. And it is truly amazing. So when you look at the big churches, they bring in the big bucks. They give from their abundance, just like the scribes. But we give from our poverty. We're not a rich church. We're a small church. We have only so many people, and yet, when you look at it, you would think that what we give could make no difference. Just like the poor girl who gave her two copper coins that added up to a penny. And those who were watching would just, you know, throw that away. That's of no use, no value. But she gave from her poverty, and we give from our poverty from our hearts, and as Jesus said, that hers was the largest, the most valuable gift. Ours are also the most valuable gifts. We do make a difference, just like the widow made a difference. She made a difference through her example. And she made a difference through what she did. Jesus gave us the job, the requirement to go out and make disciples and to take care of the least. You know, love your neighbor as yourself. Those are the requirements. That's the mission. And our women of the church, they take care of the homeless by feeding them. They take care of the low-income folks by putting together food baskets. They take care of people overseas by the blankets that we send. Just look at the bounty that we have here, that we represent here, and this makes a difference. This is huge. It really makes a difference. So we may be small, and we may be we're probably not expected to make a dent, just like the widow's two coppers. We're not supposed to make a dent. But when you talk to outside organizations, or people who have visibility of what St. Paul and Sulphur Springs does, they will tell you that we are one of the busiest, most active churches in the area. So today is Thank Offering Sunday. We thank God for giving us the ability to put together this bounty and to share it with people, the least who need it. We have to be very thankful to God for allowing us to do that. But we have to be very thankful also for our women who are willing to do the nitty-gritty, the quilts. There are a lot of work that goes into the quilts. Even the blankets, there's still a lot of money and there's a lot of time that go into the blankets. And there are rules, you know, requirements. It has to be 2 yards, 8 inches in order to go out to the Lutheran World Relief. It can't be 3 yards. The fabric can't be 3 yards. It can't be 2 yards. It can't be 2 yards and 7 inches. It has to be 2 yards and 8 inches. And that's kind of, you know, a pain. But we have women who do that. We have women who sit down, they purchase the fleece, they do the measuring, they prepare the blankets to the specifications required so that it can go out. Just amazing. It is really amazing. So I think that we say thanks to God today. We say thank you to God for allowing us to have the resources and that are needed to help carry out his mission. But we also need to say thank you to the women of our church, because the women are out there doing our mission. They are taking it to the street. They're the ones who are really pushing it. And it's not just the women, but the women are the true drivers of the majority of our mission action. So I just want to say thank you, ladies. You guys are incredible. The work that you put in, it is amazing. And it really makes a difference. And it makes a difference here in our town. But it also makes a difference by other people seeing the work that you guys do. They see that and they know that we're a small country church and we just aren't, you know, rolling in resources, but look at what they do. So you're also an example to all of the other neighborhood churches. They see that this is a church that walks the walk. So So thank you all.